This is a picture of the dunes. It's the dunes in northern Holland. It's close to where I live, actually. And I like it. It's a very tranquil moment in time, I would say. You know, you almost can think of Bob Ross talking about this happy cloud over there and, you know, things like that. So this is the way we like to look at nature. But over the past 300 years, something special has happened. And the way we look at nature now is like this. We look at all the equations underneath these processes that we observe in nature. So some of you might recognize bits and pieces of this. So this is equation, Schrödinger equation, which tells us about how things are happening on the atomic level, the quantum level, all the way up to Einstein's field equations, which tell something about how gravity keeps things together. And over the past 300 years, we've been trying to make sense of all these underlying processes. But the thing we're trying to kind of lost view of is how these things are connected. How are these bits and pieces connected? What connects the dots between all those different processes? And that's what complexity science is about. So it feels a bit like this old tale of these Indian guys that were, you know, blindfolded and were trying to make sense of that animal over there. And there's this guy over here says, well, it's not an animal, it's a big wall. And there's a guy said, no, you know, it's a piece of rope. And the guy says, no, it's a tree. And of course, the point is, by looking at bits and pieces of it, you actually miss the bigger picture. You miss what you're looking for. You miss to identify the actual thing. And this is already like 600 years before Christ, that people were trying to think about this more systemic way of looking at the world. And here's a nice quote that I'd like to share with you, which comes from Lao Tse, that says, look at the tree, a mountain, or the foam on water when it hits the shoreline, all amazingly beautiful, in all kinds of wild and crazy patterns. All of it has an order to it that we simply cannot measure or describe. This is Lee, the organic pattern. This is like, you know, 400 or 500 years before Christ. The people are thinking about, what is it? What is actually these things that are underneath all those patterns that we observe in nature? And, well, here you have a lot of patterns. And one of my heroes, well, two heroes I will mention. One of my heroes is Darcy Thompson, who in 1917 wrote this book on growth and form about how nature, tried to quantify nature. And he said that the waves in the sea, the little ripples on the shore, the sweeping curve of the sandy bay between the headlands, the outline of the hills, the shape of the clouds, all these are so many. I love this. This is like poetry, right? It's this is where the science meets poetry, where science meets art to some extent. And another of my heroes is Richard Feynman, Dick Feynman, the famous physicist, Nobel laureate. He said, nature uses only the longest threads to weave her patterns. So each small piece of her fabric reveals the organization of the entire tapestry. And that is exactly what we're looking for. So what is it that connects these things together? What is it that we can find in the smallest parts that actually builds up the bigger parts? And that understanding, trying to understand that, is what we do in complexity science. So what are complex systems? Well, there are many forms of complex systems. And here are two examples that I want to share with you. And then how do we define them, if you like? Well, my favorite definition is if a complex system is obviously not simple, right? So, and that means that the moment I take it apart, the moment I look at the complex system, I'll try to take it apart, you know, like a physicist would do, I hammer on it until I hit the atoms, and then I hammer a bit more until I hit what's underneath that. The moment I do that, I actually lose what I'm looking for, right? By taking it apart, I lose what I'm looking for. So that's what really makes it complex. And another aspect is that these are elements, these complex systems consist of elements that are constantly in interaction with each other and constantly evolving over time. And it's not only the elements evolving over time, but also the interactions are co-evolving with that. And here's this, well, a nice example of a bird flock. These are starlings. And you know, you get these very beautiful macroscopic patterns, which is an emergent behavior, which is a systemic response, if you like, of very microscopic local interaction between the birds. So it's a very good example of how you can create macroscopic patterns out of simple local interactions. And this is an animation of the immune system, which we are actually doing a lot of research on. where we just don't know how complicated, how complex that is. If it was complicated, it would be easy. How complex it is. It's tremendously, unbelievably complex, our immune system. The fact that we are all alive is just unbelievable. You know, we talk about a system that has been evolving for over 350 million years, where constantly adapting to its environment, adapting to itself. It's really absolutely amazing. And we know the bits and pieces of the molecules that constitute it, but how they work together, we actually still hardly know. So these are two examples of complex systems that all have the same aspects, a lot of components that are interacting with each other in an unpredictable fashion, if you like. So the question you can ask yourself for such a complex system is, you know, at what point in time do I lose its complexity? So the question, how much of a thought is there in one neuron? We know that our neurons, you know, firing up in your head right now, they're processing your information. There are thoughts in you. But the question is, okay, I take out neurons, and I take out more neurons, and at what point in time do I lose the concept of a thought? Or the other way around, if I start with one neuron and I add more neurons to it, at what point in time can I talk about thinking? We don't know. We just don't know. We don't know where that trade-off is. We don't know where we go from one scale to another scale. And so it's actually a nonsensical question. We have no idea how to approach this. Another one is, how wet is one molecule of water? Right? How can you ever find an answer to that? Okay, then two molecules of water. So where do you put those limits? We don't know. And I think this is going to be, I'm going to repeat this many times, we don't know. There's a tremendous amount that we do not know. But at least we know that we do not know, which is an important step forward. Okay, so another aspect, a couple of other aspects of complexity science, of complex systems. Complex systems, they don't have a manager, which is good. So there is no mastermind. There's no, you know, one person says, to this, these are penguins actually moving around. And they have, you see, they come in kind of lockstep. Nobody told them how to do that. Here, these ants, they're building a bridge to cross this space gap. Nobody told them how to do that. Complex systems, they evolve over time. They get these emergent properties that I was talking about. There's evolution, there's adaptation, and there's what we call self-organization. But a deeper understanding why these things are working, how they are working, is still very much eluding us. So these were some examples of complex systems, and many more exist. I just give a list here for you to kind of relate to. Pandemics, the spreading of diseases across the world, is a very good example of a complex system. And it's getting harder and more difficult, and as you know, with 7 billion people, that was actually in the little movie that you saw, with 7 billion people, the likelihood of us meeting each other is getting bigger and bigger, so that the likelihood of transmitting something and, you know, building up a big pandemic is getting bigger and bigger. All these examples, you know, including cities, economies, markets, you name it, these are all examples of complex systems. So I guess by now you understand a bit of the idea what a complex system is. Now, let's see if we can have a better understanding on how to study these things. You know this guy? So he, Stephen Hawking, he said that in one of the interviews he did do in, I think it was in the beginning of 2000, that the 21st century is going to be the century of complexity. And the reason why he said that is because exactly of these examples I was telling you. We know so much about the underlying processes, all the way from, you know, the gravitation equations to the Schrodinger equations to whatever all those things that we have uncovered over the last 300 years that science has uncovered. How are these things connecting? Are they connected? And can we reason about it? Can we model them? Can we study them? Can we play with them? And the thing we found in complex systems, this is already from the 80s, is that they have this very peculiar thing, is that they happen what we call at the edge of chaos. So if things are totally ordered, they're actually simple. If things are totally chaotic, they're actually also simple. But it's in between that things are happening. The moment that things are kind of, we call it out of equilibrium, not chaotic, not totally ordered, but somewhere in between, that's where the magic happens. That's where life is, and that's where complexity arises. And we can quantify that. I won't quantify it for you now, but we can quantify that. So we know exactly, we can find that point where complexity actually sets on, where it comes from the simple to the complex. So they have a couple of things in common. And we've been trying to study that for the last many years. And one way to look at it is that they consist of elements, like I said, think of those birds, think of the molecules in your immune system, think of the people in the economy. These are individuals, these individual components, they're interacting with each other. Their states, you know, what they stand for changes over time, and the interaction changes over time. So it is this co-evolution of elements and their interaction that actually defines what a complex system is about. So they co-evolve over time. And they do this by storing, exchanging, and processing information. And this is a slightly new edge of looking at things. So we take the view that we say, okay, the complex systems, what they do, they communicate things with each other, they change the state of each other, and we describe that in terms of the way they process information. And the question you can ask yourself is, can we predict their future? Because we have this feeling in science, if we can predict the future state of something, that we have a feeling we might understand something about it. So can we predict their future? Well, that is a hard question. So this is a nice quote, prediction is difficult, especially about the future. And that, well, the question is that really so? So this is actually a cue for me getting a nice glass of drink. So I plugged that in particularly there. So is it difficult? So the funny thing is, it's actually easier to predict the future than it is to retrodict the past. And the way you can look at that is this example that you just saw here. If you would walk into a room, and you see a big mess on the ground, like, you know, bits and pieces of shards of glass or something like that, and there's a bit of red into it and whatever. Then reconstructing from that picture the fact that it was a glass with a cocktail is much harder than having that glass of cocktail in your hand and thinking, calculating how much, and then calculating what it would look like if I would drop it. So walking into a room with this mess on the ground and then reproducing what that mess came from requires more information than the other way around. So that means the prediction of the future is actually simpler than predicting the past, which is kind of a weird thing for all of us, of course. But we can make use of that. We can abuse that, if you like. And this is a thing we call causal asymmetry. The past, generating the future from the past needs less information than generating the past from the future. And this is a remarkable thing, and we can use that in terms of quantifying how much information is processed in those complex systems. Now, if you talk about this, this can sound very abstract, right? So let's see if we can make that a little bit more mundane. Talking about how information is processed in a complex system. So let's do that with an example from nature, and for that we need to make a big leap of faith. You know, what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to describe nature not in terms of mass, energy, and matter, but I'm trying to describe it in terms of ones and zeros. I'm just trying to describe nature and the way nature processes information in terms of bits. So here's an example of how nature processes information. I think it's a totally cool example. So these are the bees, okay? And these are honeybees. And what happens is, so there's this one honeybee that goes out of the beehive, finds some food somewhere, and needs to communicate that back to the bee staying in the hive, right? Now, this guy Fritsch, who got the Nobel Prize for that, he discovered how it works. And what happens actually is when the bee comes back, he starts to wiggle his tail. You saw that in that little movie. He starts to wiggle his tail, walk around, and then the angle in which he walks is a measure of the angle with respect to the hive where the food is. And the time duration that he takes for that walk, so that's the time, that's actually this time over here, is a measure for how far that food is. And the speed with which he wiggles is the measure for the amount of food that's there. And it's totally amazing if you think about that, that information has been communicated. And so the way we want to describe this is we say, okay, before that bee comes back, how much would I know already about where possibly that food could be? Now we know that from observation that bees never find food further away than 14 kilometers. So given that, we say, okay, we assume that any place in those 14 kilometers, there could be food. But after this message, we know that there is less uncertainty. It's not on every place, it's only a few places because there's uncertainty. And we can actually pin down that few, that reduction in uncertainty. So before, we can calculate that, before the dance, there was 23, 24 bits of uncertainty about the angle and the direction. We can calculate that very easily. It's just one simple equation. And we know that after the dance, with all the the wiggling and the things that are going on there, there is only 16 bits of uncertainty, which means that 7 bits of information have been transferred. So this gives you the feeling, how, for a very simple example, how you can calculate how nature, or in this case bees, transfer information. It's an old idea from Shannon, of course. I might say something about that later. But so this gives you the feeling, okay, how that we can calculate the way information is shared and processed. And what we oh wow, it's alive. What's in there?
It's a passion wagon.
A passion wagon, okay.
It's a vodka style.
Okay, I'll probably get non-linear after this, thank you. If you don't mind. Oh, wow. What I'm doing here, I should be. Okay. That's good. Passion wagon. So we can do this. We can do this. This game that we play for the bees. We can do this for many things in nature. And here are two examples of work that we did ourselves. Very recent work, where we looked at biofilms. How biofilms are which are everywhere. Everything you touch has a biofilm somewhere. And we did some research in Singapore, trying to understand how biofilms are forming, etc. And this is constantly happening because bacteria are communicating with each other. They're walking around and they're telling each other, you know, what they see or how their environment is. And based on that, they grow in very particular shapes, which you see simulated over here. But you can also do that in, these are protein networks. You can also see that on a molecular level, how information is shared. And this protein network is a very crucial protein network. It's between the HIV virus proteins and the proteins of your immune system. And they are also communicating with each other. And there you can play the same game. You can play the same game, trying to quantify how information comes from the virus, if you like, to your body and back again. And mark that back again, right? Because there is this constant interaction going on between these two things, which makes it tremendously complicated, complex, I should say. Now, here's a thought. When I first came across this, I was kind of shocked to know this. But did you know that your body, every year, basically replaces every molecule in your body? Basically, every apart from like 2% or something like that, almost every molecule in your body is replaced every year. And somehow, you know, that replacement takes place in a good way, because you're still here, right? And sometimes I think they make a mistake, the molecules. When I look in the mirror in the morning, I think, oh my God, that's not right. But yeah, well, but so, I mean, this is the idea, right? So, so what? How does that molecule know where to go? And how does it know how to fit into the other molecules? And so it seems that all these bits and bytes that are happening and calculating in your body, that they somehow seem to be able to maintain your, well, what I call here structural integrity, although that integrity, like I said, maybe after this drink will change a bit. But okay, so the way we think about this now is that this structural integrity that keeps your body the way it is, that keeps your immune system the way it is, that keeps, you know, the bees talking to each other. That is underneath all that are must be something that stores and shares and transfers that information. There must be something that does that. And the way we think about that now is that these are basically networks of information. So I want to say a few words about that. Here's a network. This is a high school dating network. So have a look at it. This is in the series of interviews that was done in that period, 1993 and 1995. The blue ones are the boys. The red ones are the girls. They call it a romantic but also sexual network. I can look at this forever. So this is Harry Happy Boy here. To think of where you be yourself, right? So, I think I was down here somewhere. But you can also see, you know, if you think of life as information processing, etc., then you can also think, you know, if there is a virus, it could spread and it could hit you back again, right? You see? So looking at these things, I gain a lot of things by you just looking at this. You now understand what I mean with a network. You also see that these things are very, you know, different. There are clusters in here. There are like little tree things over here. There's all kinds of dynamics. We call those all the kind of structure. We call those topology, the topology of the network. And we want to understand how those networks are come about in nature. And 20 years ago, today 20, this is remarkable actually, if you think about it. Only 20 years ago, it was Larry Page and Sergey Brin that presented the page ranking algorithm that actually resulted in Google, right? The thing that we all use all day, every time, which was based on the concept of networks. They actually used a recursive algorithm that says, okay, the amount of links that go into one web page is a function of the quality or the ranking of that page. And it was a recursive process in there. So they used networks. And then in the same period, the same year, 1997, it was Duncan Watts and Stephen Strokatz that came up with the concept of a small world network, which is, if you like, the 6 degrees of separation. You might have heard of that. Yeah, so that means that I can reach out to any person in the world within 6 steps. So I can give my handshake to you and your handshake to someone else, etc. And in the end, we only need 6 handshakes to reach the whole world. Which is remarkable if you think of, you know, how complex such a network is with 7 billion people. And then still, there's only 6 degrees of separation that keeps us separated to some extent. And by the way, Google, the first wanted to call it Backrub. I think it's better to call it Google. Backrub, can you imagine? Can you Google this for me? Can you Backrub me? No, that's not going to work. No. Anyway, so the small world concept is this. This is me at some point in time. I did meet with this guy, so I'm one handshake away from that guy. Medvedev, you might recognize him. And he actually was one handshake away from Barack Obama. So that means that I'm 2 handshakes away from Barack Obama. And for one drink, you can shake my hand afterwards. And but know that he is also 1 handshake away from the current president. So but this gives you a bit of a feeling that even though a network can be hugely complex, that doesn't mean that particular aspects of it also have to be that complex. They can be really relatively simple. Now, what a guy called Barabasi discovered only 1 year later, so this, he was really on top of the whole thing. What they did was a funny thing. They looked at all the 10 billion, well, not all, they looked at 10 billion documents on the internet and looked at how they were connected, so how they were referring to each other, which, you know, if this, here's an, instead of people, you know, dating, now here's a page that is connected to that page because it refers to that page. Okay, so you can make a network out of that. And what the funny thing he found is what you expect is this. You expect, like, everything in nature has this bell-shaped curve. So you would expect, if you look at the amount of connections that documents have, that
There will be a few documents with only a few links. There will be a few documents with a lot of links, but somewhere in the middle, that's where most of things are happening. We all expect that. Everything in biology and sociology, etc., have this beautiful bell-shaped curve. So K stands, there's only equation you need to think of, you need to remember. K stands for the amount of connections. So I go with someone in the network, think about this happy boy. He had seven people around him, so his K value is seven, okay? So if you list all those K values, you would expect, okay, there's a few girls or boys with only a few connections, a few with a lot of connections, and the rest is in the middle. But the funny thing is, what he discovered, no, it's not like that, it's like this. And somehow you would say, okay, so what? Well, this is a crucial discovery. So instead of describing this like a bell shaped curve, you can describe it in things we call power laws or scale-free distributions. And what it means is that, here again is this K, so this says that there are there are a lot with a few connections, and there are a few with a lot of connections. Right? So in contrast to this, where there's a few with a few connections and a few with a lot of connections, here there are a lot with a few connections and a few with a lot of connections. Okay, you got that, right? I'll come back to that in a second. This is an important discovery. Why? Well, first of all, we find it everywhere. We really find it everywhere. So the immune system I showed you has the structure. The Facebook has it, Twitter has it, LinkedIn has it, all have this, one way or another, this power law distribution of the network. So it seems there's something very foundational happening there. And I'm not going to tell you the answer to that because we do not know. Right? But we do know that it's happening. So here's some work that we did ourselves. Actually, some of the people are in the room here. Rob, you're there. So this is work that we did on sexual contact networks in the United States. And this is a homosexual network, this is a heterosexual network. And again, if you look at those networks, if you analyze them, you'll find the same distribution, so the same, you know, the same equation here. So probability of having K connections is K to some kind of power here. And we can actually define that power exactly for the heterosexual and the homosexual networks. So with just two numbers, we can quantify what that network looks like. And it's totally cool. It's totally unexpected also. So with very, very limited number of additional information, we can reproduce those networks. Well, in principle, that is. And we find them everywhere. We find them in metabolic networks. Some of these are metabolic processes that are interconnected to each other. Protein networks, which I already mentioned. We find them basically everywhere. This is some work that we did on cannabis production networks here in Amsterdam and other places of the Netherlands. And here, so you hear this is... This is the cannabis production network. You cannot read this because you're not allowed to read it, yeah. Right? So these are, you know, the dots. They tell you something about what role the individual plays in that network. So it could be the owner of the production. It could be the people taking care of the seeds. Anyway, so there are all these different roles here that you can see here, like arranging fake owner's property, taking care of plants, the grow shop owner, selling to coffee shops, transporting the product. So we laid out all those things. It's a long story which I'm not going to tell you, but again, those networks have that scale-free property. And so with that, you can ask yourself your question, can we predict it? Like, that was the question it actually got me this drink here. So can we predict it? Well, that's a hard question. What you could do is you could play games with it. You could say, okay, what would happen if I would disrupt this network? I take out, you know, the owner, or I take out the kingpin or something like that. So those questions we can now ask ourselves, and it's not a straightforward thing what's going to happen. For instance, what we discovered here is it's not if you take out the one who has most of the connection, that doesn't play, that is not so important. You need to take out the ones that are very hard to be replaced. Obvious, but not that obvious when you start to do this kind of research. So let's talk a bit more about those networks. Here's an example of such a network. And what we do now, I'm trying to bring things together now. What we do now is to think of those networks as information processing networks, right? Because that was what we were looking for. So here's information going through it. Just think of it like, you know, little flashes of light, little thunderclouds happening. And you just see how information go from one to another. And we ask ourselves the question, what's really happening here? And the way we made two fundamental discoveries that I want to share with you. One is that if you look at those networks, and here again we have plotted the same K, which is this amount of connections. Remember, 7 for the boy that was happy. So so this is the one with lots of connections. This is one with only a few connections. And what we discovered, the beautiful work done by the Quax, what he discovered is that the way information goes through that network is not determined by the one who has most of the connections, like she could be, right? Or one who has hardly any connection, like I could be, but it's somewhere in the mean man in the street. So the somewhere in between is where actually the real information is being shared and this what we call dissipated through the system. And that's a pretty important discovery. Because it really gives you a different way of how to intervene in such networks, be it a sexual network, be it a cannabis network or whatever, or your immune system. So it tells you more, you know, where you have to focus on. And the second discovery should be this one. Here we go. This is if you say, okay, if I change the opinion or I change the state of an individual in that network. Sorry, guys, I didn't realize that you were there. then what happens actually? So here we go. Okay, what you're supposed to see here. So here I'm changing the opinion, if you like, of one individual in the network, and it changes from green to red, and you see it affects all the network. All the network goes from green to red. But here's one who has most connections, and I change it, and something hardly changes at all. So the message here is the guy over here is very much connected. But if I change his state, it's actually very insensitive. The network is insensitive to that Oprah Winfrey, if you like, right? So now let's make one more step. So that was one discovery. The discovery was that it's the man in the street, it's the in between that actually determines what's happening. Okay, so another thing we discovered is if you, and I think I like this one most, if you add noise to the network, if the network makes errors, if you like. So there is this network, it's doing something. Let's say it's producing a protein or it's producing cannabis. And I disrupt it. It's doing its job in a very effective way. And I disrupt it. I take out one thing or I rewire a thing or something like that. The remarkable thing is that if you do that and you would look at the performance of the network, so the efficiency with which it, for instance, generates cannabis or protects your body, that if you do add a little bit of noise of it, it actually gets better. And this is totally weird. And I'm not saying that we really understand this, but we observe it. We understand it a little bit. It is a concept from physics which is called stochastic resonance, which plays a role here. It's more the kind of, you can kind of more efficiently cross barriers. But the thing is, if this is true, and I think it's true because we observe it, that means that a little bit of noise in your network actually makes your network better. And this might be the reason why nature, in the first place, looked for networks, right? Because in nature, you want to have some kind of resilience to things that change around you, right? If your immune system, if one molecule, you know, is kicked out, and your immune system would collapse, we wouldn't be sitting here. So there has to be some kind of resilience in those networks that keep those networks doing what they should do. And the funny thing is, you actually do it better with a little bit of noise. Of course, if you add more noise to it, then the whole thing will collapse, of course. So you have to be very careful how much you're doing there. So these are two important discoveries. One is it's not the hubs, it's the man in the street that drives the network. And the second thing is add a bit of noise and the whole thing still actually works, and it might even work better. And here's a simulation of that same effect. We tried to get information, a signal, this could be a signaling network, from one place to another place, and then we actually calculate the performance of that. And you see that it actually goes to an optimum. So I thought this was a totally cool result. So where does all this information come from? It's a silly question, but silly questions are also always the most funny questions also, the most interesting questions to address. So where does all this information that these things are processing, where does it come from? Well, there have been people have been thinking about this forever, and all the way from people like Sadi Carnot, who started to talk about entropy in steam engines, to people like Clausius and Gibbs and Boltzmann that to say, okay, well, we can describe this in the way molecular chaos is actually evolving over time, all the way up to this guy here, Claude Shannon, who kind of reformulated that whole thing into a information theoretical concept. And this, we're talking about right after the Second World War. This guy came up with a theory, which I think is one of the most solid results of science of the last century, which is a theory that describes information in a very quantitative way for the first time. Absolutely brilliant mind. So where does all this information come from? Well, the way you can think about this is just, this is the last equation. The way you can think about it is actually very simple. You can think about is there's free energy somewhere. Well, the energy somewhere comes from the sun, right? We get all our energy from the sun. So there's free energy somewhere, which is translated into something which we call entropy, which is somehow related to information or minus of information, if you like. There's much, if you look at this equation, there's much to tell about that. But a beautiful thing, it tells us that in the end, everything will become chaos. Because if this says that the entropy, the disorder in the system, will increase over time. Since the second law of thermodynamics will tell us, in the end, everything will become chaos. But before it becomes chaos, there are these little bits and pieces of structure, which we call life, which are stored in information systems. So what I'm saying here is that the energy that the sun gives to the earth is transformed into something we can call information. Right, so the way to look at it is like this. The sun just gives us bits, right? And we need to make sense of that. We need to kind of understand what that means for life, for complex systems. And so what we can conclude, I think, is the following. And this is my take-home message to you, and after that you can get drunk. So nature transforms this free energy that I'm talking about, that is given by the sun. It transforms this Gibbs-free energy into complex systems that I've been talking about for the last half hour. And they create those complex systems at the edge of chaos, because if it would be chaos, then it would be totally, you know, it would be dead, if you like. So it creates those complex systems at the edge of chaos, and nature uses networks to register, share, and process that information. Right, and all the while, nature is just computing its own future. It's just calculating its own next state. So nature is doing that. And then you can ask yourself the question, what's the point of it? Why would nature be doing that? What would be, why would it be doing that? Well, my guess is just for fun. Thank you.